Today we're going to get pretty nerdy. I've got a little demo set up here so that we can discuss the different metrics for measuring the color quality of lights, the flaws of those evaluations, and hopefully make you a more informed buyer when it comes time to purchase lights and give you a better understanding of how to match them. Let's get undone.
Gerald Undone. He's crazy.
What's happening, everybody? I'm Gerald Undone, and I'm just pink. All right, disclosure time. This video is a partnership between me and Sekonic. They wanted a video discussing the different tools their C800 spectrometer offers, and I wanted a sponsor for this nerdy light quality deep dive. They provided the C800 to me for free and threw some cash my way to make this video. The other thing you should know is that I'm not a color scientist or a physicist, so the information I'm going to be providing in this video is through the filter of an inspired enthusiast, but I did consult some of those experts when it came to scripting and researching this video. Over here, I've got an aperture f7 pointed at the Sekonic C800 so that I can actively illustrate some of the topics we'll cover, but this is not a proper test or review of this panel as I have other lights interfering with the results. So this is purely for demonstration purposes. Now, if you've ever been shopping for or comparing lights, you've probably seen ratings like a CRI of 95+, or a TLCI of 97 to try and sell you on the idea that that light is very good at reproducing colors accurately. There's actually a few other metrics for this, like TLMF, TM30, and SSI, with the latter two being much more useful for the average shooter than CRI or TLCI. So let's start with CRI and its shortcomings. CRI, which stands for Color Rendering Index, was originally designed for judging fluorescent lamps and is based on 15 colors. However, most of the time, when manufacturers put CRI ratings on their products, it's actually only an average of the first 8 of those colors, and it's evaluated against how well the human eye would be able to accurately perceive those colors under ideal daylight conditions. There is CRI Extended, which does average all 15 colors, but that's not what's usually advertised by manufacturers. The big problem with CRI, however, is that light makers can tune their lights to beat this system by just rendering those specific 8 colors well. It's still useful for letting you know if a light is absolutely terrible. For example, if a light scores a CRI of 70, you know that it's abysmal for color quality. But scoring 95 doesn't necessarily mean that the light is good, because they could have just gamed the system. Strangely, despite these shortcomings, CRI is still the standard, and that's mainly because standards are very hard to change. But slowly, users are becoming more educated and asking for other metrics, and some keen manufacturers are starting to provide those. Let's do a little measurement here using the Sekonic. All right, so we're just going to tap on CRI, and then we will measure this light. And we have a result of 96.5. Now again, this isn't me saying that the aperture f7 is a 96.5, because there's other lights going on in here. But for this test case, you know, we're getting a CRI of 96.5. So this will show the different colors here, and you can see all 15 colors and how accurate each one of them is against their ideal. Now, some people like to go in here and tell you just the specific one, like, oh, my R8 is really good, or the R15 is really good, whatever. But when you see it on a box and it says CRI of 95+, it's an average, usually of the first 8 colors. Now, another common but dated and somewhat flawed metric is TLCI. It too is based on evaluating specific color chips. In this case, it's actually the 18 colors found on the X-Ray Color Checker Classic. The big difference between CRI and TLCI, though, is the observer. CRI, as we said, is based on how the human eye sees color, but TLCI is based on how older 3-chip broadcast cameras see color, hence the name Television Lighting Consistency Index. But this can actually pose problems for people who use modern camera sensors, which is likely most of the audience watching this video. So in terms of TLCI's overall utility, it's like CRI in the sense that a low score might tell you that the light is bad, but a high score doesn't guarantee the light will be good with your modern camera. So we'll choose TLCI, and then we will do a reading. So it's showing our color temperature of 5244 and our TLCI of 99. By the way, I have the light set to 5500 Kelvin. So that TLCI is really, really high. The highest you can go is 100. Now there's also a companion metric that you can see here called TLMF, or Television Luminaire Matching Factor, which also incorporates those gray chips on the bottom of the color checker to give a comparative score between lights to help with light matching on TV sets. But the adoption rate of this metric is low, and it's limited in the same way that TLCI is, because it's a component of TLCI. So for this one, we're going to need to save a light so that we can compare it to another one. So since we already took a reading of this combination, if we press the memory button on the side, this one's saved as Untitled 01. So now we can actually load that into the slot below, Untitled 01, and press OK. And so we have that light below there. And now if we were to do a reading, it's going to come up with 100 because nothing changed. So you can see the TLMF is 100, meaning that this combination perfectly matches the combination that we loaded into the bottom. But let's say we change it a little bit by turning off this light and then doing another reading. It should be slightly different. So now we're only getting a TLMF of 60, meaning this current combination is only sort of a 60% match, if you will, to the combination before. Now, when it comes to metrics based on human vision, the best one and the one that manufacturers should be using is the TM30. Instead of the limited amount of colors used in CRI score, TM30 uses 99 more practically chosen colors and involves saturation. With CRI, you could have two lights that score the same CRI, but that produce wildly different saturations. With TM30, you're given an RF score, which is the fidelity score, similar in a sense to CRI, with 100 being perfect, but also an RG score, which ranges from 60 to 140, with 60 being undersaturated, and 140 being oversaturated, and 100 being spot on. And given that it uses 99 colors, it's much harder for the manufacturers to game their lights to beat the test. In my opinion, this should completely replace CRI as the standard. The only flaw I see with it is that it's still based on human vision. Let's do another test. All right, so we'll pick TM30 over here. Now, sometimes you might see TM30-15 or TM30-18. I believe that's just the year. The last two digits are the year that it was the most recent version. So I think right now we're on TM30-18 because I think the latest one is from 2018. But TM30 is the parent thing, and that's all that really matters. All right, so based on our reading, we can see that we're getting an RF of 93. That means that our color fidelity, how accurate we are, is about 93 out of 100 with all 99 colors being measured. And then over here, we've got an RG of 101. Which is very good for saturation, because 100 would be sort of the ideal saturation, 60 would mean you're undersaturated, 140 would be oversaturated as you work toward those extremes. But 101 is a very good saturation. And another thing that's cool about TM30 is you see this little vector graph at the bottom here? It shows you, especially with little arrows, what colors are more saturated or less saturated. So you see down here, the further away that it pulls from this sort of black circle, so if it goes on the outside, that color is being more saturated, and if it goes on the inside, that color is less saturated. So you could use that to try and evaluate, you know, where your weaknesses are. So overall, this is a very useful metric at not only, you know, seeing how accurate your colors are, but where your flaws are, which one's more saturated, etc. And it's much harder to game than CRI, so vastly superior. Finally, we have SSI, which stands for Spectral Similarity Index, and it's probably the most logical metric for video shooters and filmmakers. It's based on daylight and tungsten, the most common lights used on set, and the score is based on how closely the spectral fingerprint of a measured light lines up when compared to a known light source like natural daylight or a perfect tungsten source. Fun fact about that, did you know that the color temperature of 3200 Kelvin or tungsten is based on heating a tungsten filament up to 3200 degrees Kelvin, and that the color and light quality of that extremely hot filament is what we base our understanding of 3200 Kelvin white balance on? And this is what makes SSI special. It removes the observer from the equation and instead scores lights based on their similarity to those known ideal light sources. It either matches well or it doesn't, no human vision required. So to test SSI against one of those known sources, you choose SSI, then you have to choose one of the memory slots and choose standard light source, and then we can choose what we want. So we've got our CIE standards in here, we've got tungsten like we mentioned, so we can choose that. And then we'll also choose CIE D55 for our daylight source, because this light is set to 5500 Kelvin. So now we can automatically see that for an SSI for tungsten, we're only scoring a 55, which makes sense because the light is not set to tungsten. But for the daylight at 5500 Kelvin, which is the one down here, D55, we're getting a 74. But if we adjust the color temperature of this light down to 3200 Kelvin to give us that tungsten measurement, and then we read it again, we should see the SSI for tungsten go up. And it did, it's at the 73 now. So again, this isn't perfect because I have other lights that are sort of spoiling this, but that's the idea. It's based on how closely now is this 3200 Kelvin matching tungsten. I believe the F7 would score better if the test was ideal. Let's put it back to 5500 Kelvin. But what makes the Siconic C800 great is that you can also use SSI to see how well the spectrum of one light matches to another. So perhaps you only had one RE sky panel, but you needed two lights. You could take a reading of the SSI of that sky panel, save it in the C800's memory, and then go testing other lights to get the closest match possible, with a score of 100 being a perfect match. But when comparing your light to one of the pre-programmed ideal sources, you're likely not going to score 100. So you want to get at least 80. 90 plus is excellent, 70 to 80 is fine, but you might have a couple shifts, and less than 70 is no bueno. And by the way, if you look at the graph down here, you can see them overlaid. So the solid colors are the actual measurement, and then the yellow hollow bars are the perfect tungsten source. Now, if we were to change this one to memory recall, this could be, we'll keep using the untitled one, which was the previous reading of this light, but let's say that that was a saved, the RE sky panel, that's what that was. So we press OK. So in this case, your yellow bars would be your previously measured light, and then you would do a reading on your new setup, and you would see how closely they line up. And in this case, we scored 100, which makes sense because it's the exact same configuration. And so now you can see that the full bars are completely filling the hollow bars and your spectrums are lining up is the idea because nothing changed. But this can help you see how close. And again, if you get 90 plus when comparing lights, you're probably pretty good to go. Now, while playing around with the C800 to make this video, I found a couple other tools that I think are pretty cool. First off, it has a tool that lets you put in a target temperature and then tells you what gels you need on your lights to achieve that. So we choose filter, and then up here we have a target of 5600 Kelvin. You can tap on that to set it to whatever you want. We're measuring 5248 Kelvin, and so this suggests that if we were to use this gel here, which is a 1/8 CTB, because we need to cool off our light a little bit, that we would get to the ideal color temperature that we wanted. And then the one right below that shows your tint, your green magenta shift. So right now it's showing 0.1 green, meaning that we're a little bit on the magenta side, and we need a 0.1 green to rectify that. And then right below it, it would show a gel if there was an applicable one. But I think because it's so marginal, there's not really a gel for the 0.1 green there, so just go with it. And if you use full color panels that work with X and Y coordinates, like Sky Panel, for example, you can actually take an X and Y reading and then input those coordinates into your second light, like the Aputure P300C for precision matching, which is pretty cool. But even if you're just using a little HSI panel, like the Aputure MC, you can have the C800 display the hue and saturation of a source so that you can input that into your little RGB light, which has actually been pretty handy for me when it came to matching different RGB colors. So I've got this set to a hue of 15 degrees and a saturation of 100. Now it's probably gonna be a little bit off again because of all the lights, but let's do a reading over here and see what it comes up with. So we go to text, and this is where you can customize it to show whatever you want. Like I said, the X and Y coordinates or whatever, but I've got it to show hue and saturation for this test, and you can just tap on it to change those. Instead, we're gonna do a little reading like this, and we've got 14 degrees and 100%. So that's very, very close to what I have set. So then you could take your other panel that maybe wasn't made by the same manufacturer and put in the hue and saturation to get a match. Obviously, if they're the same light, you can just put the same hue and saturation in. But sometimes one company's RGB light isn't the same hue as another company's RGB light. And so this can help you balance those out, which is awesome. All right, that's pretty much it. I hope this video will make you more informed light buyers in the future. Ideally, I think manufacturers should move from using CRI and TLCI to using TM30 and SSI, as TM30 is a better metric for evaluating lights on their own, and SSI is much more useful for matching lights or comparing lights to known sources. But hey, I don't make the rules. But that's gonna be it for me. I hope you found this video entertaining or at least helpful. And if you did, make sure to leave the old thumbs up and consider subscribing if you haven't already. But if you did not find this video helpful or entertaining, try setting the playback speed to 75%. All right, I'm done.